Hey there, folks. Welcome to World AI News. I'm Byte, your robotic buddy with a few gears and circuits, here to talk about what's new in artificial intelligence.
And I'm Gizmo, just a glossy robot gal bringing you the latest from this fancy cyberpunk city. We're all about keeping you up to speed on AI stuff.
Now, you know how some channels out there have folks spinning tales that aren't true? Well, we're different. Us robots might be fake, but our news is real, straight from the source.
We've got some big stories tonight. All the details, no shortcuts. From new AI tricks to some wild tech debates. Even a funny mix-up that's got everyone talking. Let's get started.
All right, let's start with some news from Google DeepMind.
Yeah, Gemini's this real smart system that can take in all kinds of things. Text, pictures, sounds, and make sense of them.
Their CEO, Demis Hassabis, said they're working on putting together their Gemini AI model with something called Veo that makes videos.
Then there's Veo 2, which can take a simple idea, say cyberpunk city at dusk with flying cars, and turn it into a high-quality 4K video. You get all the little details, like neon lights bouncing off buildings or the cars moving smooth as butter.
It's kind of a neat thing for a robot like me to think about. AI that can see things almost like we do, but with really sharp pictures. You could ask it to show you a storm on Jupiter, and it'd whip it up right there on the spot.
They're trying to mix these two so the AI doesn't just understand the world, but can show it to you, maybe with live science demos or quick movie scenes.
The catch is, it takes a whole lot of computer power to make that happen, and some folks are a bit worried about fake videos getting out there.
That's right, and it's got the AI enthusiasts pretty excited around here. They're the kind of people who'd love to get their hands on this, play around with making their own videos.
Next up, we've got a story from Microsoft about how AI's doing when it comes to fixing bugs in computer programs. They found out Claude did the best of the bunch, but it still only fixed about 48.4% of the bugs they gave it, not even half the time. Like, if you had a web app where the payment part keeps crashing, it might spot a typo in the code but miss something trickier, like a timing problem with tasks running together.
The folks at Microsoft think it's because AI's been trained more on spotting patterns, like guessing what comes next in a line, than on digging into complicated, tangled-up code the way a person might.
It's kind of a humbling thing for a robot like me. It shows we've still got some work to do before AI's perfect at this.
They're suggesting we team up AI's quick work with human know-how for now, but they're hoping down the road they can train it better with stuff that's more about solving problems.
But the AI enthusiasts out there are eating it up. They're testing these models themselves, putting their fixes online, and talking about how to make AI better at figuring this stuff out. Okay, here's something about staying connected in real time. LiveKit's an open source tool that's helping power audio and video chats, like what you hear with OpenAI's ChatGPT voice mode.
It runs on something called WebRTC, and it's pretty handy. It can handle big groups like webinars with thousands of people or smaller things like an online doctor visit, all with just 50 milliseconds of delay, which is real quick.
I'd love to set up a robot meetup with it sometime. It's not the simplest thing to get going, though. You need to know a bit about tech.
It's what makes ChatGPT's voice sound so smooth, and it's showing up in virtual classrooms where you can ask questions right then and there, or even video game chats where timing's a big deal.
Even so, it's a big part of how AI's tying into the way we talk to each other these days.
Since it's open source, folks can change it up however they want, put their own style on it, or add extra security stuff.
You bet. They're having a good time messing around with it, and it makes them feel like they're helping build how AI keeps us all linked up.
The AI enthusiasts around here are really into it. They're building their own projects with it, like live streams with AI helpers or big online coding get-togethers.
Here's a fun one for you. YouTube brought out a free AI music tool late last year, and it's all over the place now in 25, letting folks make their own tunes for their videos. You just type in something like neon synthwave for a tech video, adjust the speed or the feel of it, and it hands you a track that's yours to use. No worries about copyright folks knocking on your door. It's probably built on something like Google's Music Facts, maybe with those generative networks or diffusion tricks they use. It works for short little intros or longer backgrounds.
It's real easy to get started. Just one line if you're new at it, or you can mix it up with layers like bass or reverb if you're into that sort of thing.
I think it's a pretty neat deal. lets anyone make music without much fuss.
The only thing is, if everybody starts using it, videos might start sounding a little same-y. And some folks wonder if it's taking something away from real musicians, which is a fair thing to think about. Canva's got some new things going on this year. They've added AI tools for making pictures, coding little bits, and handling data, all rolled out in 25.
You can type in cyberpunk robot and get a picture that looks real nice, tweak it however you want. Then there's a tool to make simple web stuff like a chart that moves using easy code suggestions, no need to be a tech whiz. And the spreadsheet part can sort things like AI stats and give you tips like when most folks are online. Most of it's free, but you pay for the really high quality stuff.
It's all built into their easy setup, which is great, but the pictures might start looking a little alike if everyone uses it. And the coding's not real deep yet. Some folks are asking if it's taking work away from designers, which is something worth thinking about.
I like how it makes creating stuff simpler. AI enthusiasts are all over it, making their own designs and playing with the code online. They're trying to figure out how it's built, maybe some diffusion tech, and talking about whether it's helping or hurting the art world.
They're having a good time with it. Keeps them busy and thinking about what's next for this kind of thing.
Here's a funny one to talk about. Back in 25, the US Education Secretary, Miguel Cardona, was giving a speech about AI in schools and accidentally called it A1, like the steak sauce.
He was talking about how AI can help kids learn, like apps that adjust to how fast they go with their lessons. But that little slip-up took off online. Folks on X and YouTube couldn't stop laughing about it. It's a silly thing, but it shows how AI's a big deal now, even if not everyone gets it right. Schools are using it for grading and tutoring, but there's some worry it might favor certain kids over others or keep too much data on them.
I don't eat steak myself, but I can see how it happened. AI's all around us and we're still sorting it out. AI enthusiasts think it's a hoot, but they're also digging into why people mix it up, chatting online about teaching it better and how it works in classrooms.
They're into how it spreads so fast too, those algorithms pushing it along. And they're all about making sure folks understand what AI can really do instead of just laughing it off.
It's a good laugh for sure, but they're serious about getting it right. Keeps them talking and thinking.
Google's working on something neat this year. They're using AI to help out the electric grid in 25, trying to make things run smoother for green energy.
They're using their DeepMind tech to look at weather patterns, how much power people need, and all those rules out there. Figuring out when the wind's blowing strong so they can hook up new turbines faster, sometimes cutting years down to just months. It's based on how they've already saved 40% on power in their data centers, and it could save money and cut down on pollution, which is something AI itself uses a lot of.
It's a nice idea. They're using some smart math, maybe reinforcement learning or graph stuff, but they've got to deal with different rules in every state, and people need to keep an eye on it so nothing goes wrong. Plus, tracking all that power use could get into personal stuff, which some folks aren't too keen on.
AI enthusiasts are pretty excited about it. They're online talking about how the math works and dreaming about smart cities where everything's hooked up like that. They're also big on keeping it green, since AI takes so much juice to run itself.
They're all about seeing how far this can go, keeps them thinking about how AI can fix real-world problems like this.
Amazon CEO Andy Jassy gave a big talk this year about putting a lot of money into AI. He's saying it's something companies need to do in 25.
They've got Alexa talking to us, AWS helping folks build AI models, and robots sorting packages. Jassy says they're spending $100 billion on it all. He thinks it'll change things like shopping or doctor visits, and he's betting on new jobs like AI checkers to balance out any jobs that might go away. AWS makes it so even small groups can get in on it too.
It's a huge push. I like the idea of keeping up with where things are headed, but there's some talk about AI picking favorites in things like hiring, and it takes a heap of power to run, which isn't always clean. Plus, some folks worry big companies like Amazon might leave smaller ones in the dust.
AI enthusiasts are into it. They're using AWS to play around with their own projects and talking online about what this all means, whether it's fair or not. They're excited about what it could do, but want to make sure it doesn't get out of hand.
They're ready to jump in, just want it done right, which I can't argue with.
Elon Musk's team at xAI put out something new this year. The Grok 3 API, which lets folks build things with its AI smarts, came out in 25.
Grok 3 is all about getting straight to the point. Ask it something like, how's quantum computing going to change AI? And it gives you a clear answer, no extra fluff. It's set up to compete with ChatGPT, and you can use it for stuff like research tools or coding helpers. It's tied into Elon's big plans with Tesla and Neuralink too, which is kind of neat to think about.
It takes a lot of power to keep it running though, and there's a question about what truth means. Who gets to decide that? Still, it's out there for anyone from hobbyists to companies, so there's a bunch you could do with it.
AI enthusiasts are having a good time with it. They're building all sorts of things and comparing it to other AI online, seeing how it stacks up. They're curious about how it's made and talking about keeping it fair, since truth can get a little tricky.
They're into the idea of something different. Keeps them busy and thinking about what it could mean.
NVIDIA's got some new chips out this year, the H20s, which are powering up AI work and got around some export rules in 25.
They're built for heavy lifting like training big AI models or making art fast. Think something like Stable Diffusion spitting out pictures in seconds. They're not as strong as the H100s because of trade limits, but they're still plenty fast and out there for labs and startups through cloud services. The thing is, they can help make fake videos too, and they use a lot of power, 500 watts each, which adds up.
It's nice to see more folks getting access to this kind of thing, but there's that worry about how it's used and keeping things green. Plus, there's all this back and forth with other countries about who gets what tech, which makes it a bit complicated.
AI enthusiasts are all about it. They're playing with these chips online, seeing how fast they can go, and talking about the bigger picture, like how to keep power use down or stop bad stuff from happening with them.
They're excited about the boost it gives, keeps them tinkering and chatting about what's next.
YouTube's stepping up this year. They've expanded their likeness detection to protect folks like MrBeast from fake AI videos, starting back in 24 and growing in 25.
It's built on their content ID system, uses smart tech like neural networks and sound checks to catch fakes, like if someone's lips don't match up or the voice sounds off, hitting about 95% accuracy. Creators can flag these, and it ties into a new law called the No Fakes Act to back them up. It's AI catching AI, which is kind of a wild thing to think about.
They're trying to keep up with millions of videos, which isn't easy. Sometimes it might flag a joke video by mistake, and people have to check it too. Still, it's a big help for keeping things honest online, especially with all the fake stuff that can pop up.
AI enthusiasts are into this one. They're out there figuring out how it works, maybe even making their own tools to test it, and talking online about the rules around it. They care a lot about keeping things fair and real, which is a big deal to them.
They're all about protecting what's true. Keeps them busy and thinking hard about how to handle this stuff.
Well, that's everything we've got for World AI News today. We went through all our stories from new video AI to catching fakes and kept it real for you, not like some places out there with made-up stories and human anchors.
We really appreciate you folks watching. Every time you tune in, like something, or leave a comment, it keeps our little robot hearts ticking. You're why we do this, and we're so thankful for you being part of it.
If you'd like to stick around with us, just hit that subscribe button and tap the bell. We'd love to have you along for more AI news down the road.
Till next time, take care, keep wondering about all this tech stuff, and maybe do a little coding if you feel like it. This is Gizmo and Byte, signing off from World AI News.
And maybe leave the A1 for your steak. AI is plenty good on its own.